coming to you live from Radio Cayman Studio.
For the record.
For the record.
For the record.
Hear from your government officials, independents, and the opposition on issues that matter to you.
For the record.
Engage in an open dialogue between residents and lawmakers.
For the record.
For the record.
Informative, impartial, insightful.
This is your talk show.
1-800-534-8255. Your calls, your input. This is For the record. And now, your host, Orit Connor.
Good morning and welcome to For the Record. Today being Monday, the 10th day of April 2017. Trust that you all had a great weekend, enjoyable one. I first of all would like to give kudos to the organizers of the Feed Our Future ride yesterday. It was a 100-mile ride, and I want to talk not so much about the ride itself, but about the purpose of the ride and the beneficiaries of the funds that were raised at that ride as well. So kudos go out to the Cayman Islands Cycling Association, president of that association, Mr. Craig Merrin, all of his supporting staff, Raul Nicholson Coe, Andrew McLaughlin, Cookie, who works at Vamp Motors, the people at the Red Cross who lent their support as well. All of those persons who helped as marshals to drive vehicles, Gary Whitaker, I'm calling names at the running the risk of forgetting some, but I would say all of those who were involved, and then of course the beneficiaries, Feed Our Future, Cayman, Stacey Vanderbilt and her crew. Substantial amount of money raised, and all of that money will go to Feed Our Future Cayman. None of it is retained by the Cayman Islands Cycling Association. It all goes there, and all accounted for, transparency in the process, all funds are accounted for. As a matter of fact, I was talking to Raul on Saturday, and he mentioned to me that they even received donations from overseas, one overseas organization, and one of the reasons for that was they were able to go onto their website and see exactly how the money was raised, how it was spent, and everything. And it is that type of transparency that donors want to see, and once they see that, they're more than willing to donate. And of course, special thanks go out to all of the cyclists who participated in it. Had really nice weather at first, nice and cool and a little bit overcast, and then the hot sun came out, and that's when it became a little bit more challenging, but many people finished. A lot of them got in their 100 plus miles, some 118, some 105, some 106. Some people rode down to the event, which started at Papagallos and ended at Papagallos after going out to Rum Point via Queens Highway, back to the Frank Sound Junction, one more loop around Queens Highway, and then back down to Papagallos. And we should not forget Papagallos as well. They provided the services after in terms of a lunch, and I think it's the Jake Scott group of companies that provided the ingredients for the meal, which was then cooked by Restaurante Papagallos for free as well. Craig, if I get anything wrong, send me a WhatsApp and I'll cover it. But again, I want to thank you and thank everyone. Now, the money raised is probably not as much as some other organizations are able to raise by virtue of having walks or runs, but we want again to thank the cycling community and even those who are not involved in cycling for rendering their support. This is the third consecutive year that Feed Our Future Cayman ride has been organized as well. So again, and I want to thank you our listening and viewing audience for allowing Radio Cayman and by extension For the Record into your homes, into your vehicles as you traverse the busy roads of the Cayman Islands, into your places of work, whether it be an office cubicle or if you're working in the outdoors. For the Record is a show produced by the staff and management of Radio Cayman, and it is geared towards keeping you abreast of issues as they arise and play out on the local, regional, and international scene. I am your host, Orit Connor, and you're welcome to join me every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday from 7:30 a.m. until 9:30 a.m. Our phone lines are always open, and guess what? There's always that beautiful radio voice of Miss Susan Watson waiting to take your calls. You can call us on our toll-free number provided courtesy of Flo. That toll-free number is 1-800-534-8255. You can also call us on 949-8037 and 949-6990. Of course, if you don't like to talk on the telephone, you can email us at For the Record. That is one word, For the Record, at CANDW.KY. And for those of you who believe that I may have forgotten about our countdown, we are now 43 days, 23 hours, 23 minutes, and 12 seconds away from the 24th day of May 2017. And of course, you know that is election day as well. Getting pretty close. We just want to remind you, all of those on the road this morning, the southbound lane of the Linford Pearson Highway, portion of that has been open. Not difficult to navigate at all. So hopefully traffic won't be backed up on it, that drivers will get themselves accustomed to the road as quickly as possible. Not difficult to navigate at all. Really smooth riding, driving coming in this morning on that as well. So want to remind you of that. Be extra careful. Lots of work going on there. Want to commend the National Roads Authority for the work that they're doing, you know, on that stretch of road as well. And of course, today being Monday, it is my pleasure to have in the studio with me Dr. Steve Macfield. Dr. Macfield, morning, sir. Welcome to For the Record. Trust you had a good weekend.
Good morning to you, Mr. For the Record, and good morning to your listening audience. Locally and abroad. Yes, I had a great weekend. It was good for me. I did had some rest, and I did some writing, and I did some reading. Of course, okay. My reading. So I read most of the stuff you sent to me for the old trade bins from the 1960s. You seem to have had a great weekend too.
Yes,
and I want to thank Craig and congratulate you guys for all the good work you were doing raising funds to help the community. The only sad part about the weekend is the news that I heard on Saturday evening about the cult violence that are continuing in the country, and it really bothers me to see that we're doing not very much to arrest this trend that it seems to be the usual weekend stuff now. Either someone getting shot or killed in a nightclub or in a Mile Beach Road or something. But this new spate of violence now of robbery and the firearms and stuff is something new to us, and I think that we ought to really put a stop to it now. And I think that our politicians have to stop hiding behind the provisions in the Constitution that says that the governor is responsible for crime and for the police. The crime and policing is everybody's business.
Yes.
And we are the citizens of this country paying the salaries for all these people. And I don't think that you can hide behind that provision and any longer that says that, well, it's not my fault, it's the governor's fault and so forth. And that has to be stopped. And I think that is something that we ought to be paying close attention to. The panicking of citizens, as I saw it in a video, running away and fearful of their lives, and people now are fearful for their lives, not only in the public but in their homes as well. And I think that we ought to do something about that. And I hope that's addressed by the people who are now vying to be our representatives, the government, that they come out and they do something about it and they have a plan of how to arrest this spate of gun violence in our country.
Mm-hmm. And let's put you in their shoes. If you were a candidate on a platform and you were talking about crime in the Cayman Islands, what would be some of the issues that you would seek to address, and how would you go about addressing those issues?
Well, the first thing one of the first things that I would do would seal our borders like a cork. That's the first thing, to seal the borders like a cork so that nobody gets in and nobody goes out. And then we can deal with what we have inside, because we don't know if people are coming in and people are going out on a daily basis and robbing and killing. Secondly, I will tackle unemployment. That is a scourge upon the land. People who are unemployed and are hungry will do anything to get money. And then I would talk about not only about education and an opportunity for people, and things like after school classes and programs for people, so that they can catch up. And the education, my education plan would be, the emphasis would be on providing the necessary skills to go into the jobs that we have available. I do not understand, when you have all of these jobs for bankers, for lawyers, for accountants, for trust officers, for mutual funds administrators and stuff, and we don't have any Caymanians doing those things. Those are the things that we should be educating our children for from time they're 6 and 7, 8 years old, and for the rest of the service industry. All the services, we should be in them, and there should be nobody unemployed and nobody seeking to kill somebody to get money. And all of those programs I would do a trade school, not just to teach a trade, but to get the interest of young people, to get them out of sitting around and cooking up things to do, so that they can probably find a way to another friend to get together to do something bad. All of those things, and not just to teach a guy or a girl how to paint a car, mm-hmm. it's a place to keep them occupied, to keep their minds occupied. Remember now, in my generation, we had the privilege to have been taught all of these things by some other people when you went to work for them. Mm-hmm. Today you can't do that now easily. So, and then we have to have a security force with the necessary equipment and stuff, detection and security to secure the country. We cannot continue to go this way, because you cannot continue to do the same things and expect different results. And this is what has been happening to us now. And then we have to nick this scourge in the bud, and we have to go back to the basics to see what's wrong with them. And we don't need any experts to pay them $300, $400, $500 for a report, $100,000 for a report. We have the expertise right here. It's good old GOCC, good old Cayman common sense, GOCS, good old Cayman common sense. That is all that we need.
Okay, folks, I want to remind you that you're listening to For the Record. I'm your host, Dorrit Connor. My guest in the studio with me this morning, Dr. Steve MacPhail. We're talking, I'm putting out a scenario to him, a hypothetical situation where if he were a candidate for elections, what would he be talking about, some of the issues and some of the solution to those issues as well. When we return, I want to hear from Dr. Steve about the public's responsibility to help us in deterring crime, and also get his views on firearms licensing and who should be eligible to get a firearms license as well. Please stay tuned for the record. We'll be back shortly. Good morning. Welcome back to For the Record. In the studio with me this morning, Dr. Steve Macfield. We have two callers, so we're going straight to the phone lines. First caller, good morning. Welcome to For the Record.
Good morning, O.C. and Ms. Dr.
Macfield. Good morning,
good morning,
sir.
I'm
getting my lines crossed up there. It's really, really sad to see the degree of crime that is creeping into the Cayman Islands these days. One of the observations I'd like to make is that over the years we've had a number of discussions about the degree to which firearms is used in our society illegally. And what is clear to me that is happening, and which I've been arguing for many years, is that just because you, meaning a security company or a business, takes the position that you're not going to provide defense that is with personnel that are armed, does not mean that criminals won't misuse firearms to attack you. And we believe, and reasonably so, based upon policies that have been articulated and the way the law is worded, the way the policy has been developed around the law, that most security guards, perhaps it's believed that none might be armed. That we have unarmed vehicles, even though it's called an armored car, not armed with firearms, but armed with a reinforced vehicle, is being attacked and the officers being shot at. In my mind, and I would think in the mind of a reasonable person, that if you're unarmed and you're being shot or shot at, you might want to take a different approach to how you are doing things. And I would think that that would mean that if someone is going to attack you with a degree of force that is beyond your natural abilities, that it would be in your interest, just even from an officer's personal perspective, to not want to be at such a disadvantage against a criminal. That's just for their life alone. We're not even talking about the money. Just their life.
Right.
So we see that this is happening, and the question is, how long will we sit there and be delusional about the fact that we're being attacked? Because the rationale was all along, when I was arguing that that this is going to happen, I was being told that, well, if you arm them, then that just escalates things. But we see that the aggression is actually being escalated by the attacker. In the absence of firearms.
Okay. Caller, I'm going to ask you if you can wrap up, because we want to try to accommodate the other caller before we go to the 8 o'clock news break.
Well, there are many other issues, including immigration and illegal work and so forth, that is taking place on the island that I think we need to look at as we think about crime and illegal entry into the island. There are some things that perhaps we should be talking about on air regarding how we can deal with this. Mm-hmm. I have some ideas, and I'm going to work on them.
Okay. Thank you very much, caller, for that call. Caller, good morning. Welcome to For the Record.
Good morning, Mr. O.C.
Good morning, ma'am. How are you?
Good morning to Dr. Steve.
Good morning, ma'am. Good morning.
And I trust that both of you and your family members are well.
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you. And we trust the same for you.
I don't have much to say, not because the 8 o'clock news is coming up, but you know I'm not long-winded. I'm very sorry about what happened with that robbery, and I pray that the the man or men who were injured will soon be well again. And I pray for their families too, because imagine how frightened their families, members must be. And believe it or not, we need to pray for those who did the robbery, that God will speak to their hearts and change them. And Dr. Steve, I have a little information for you.
Thank you.
Do you remember Miss Una Bush, who used to play the organ at the Presbyterian Church before Mr. Ferdinand started playing?
Yes, ma'am.
Well, listen, Miss Effie Anderson was not family to Mr. Val Anderson and those other people, because I knew all those Andersons. She was related to Miss Una Bush, and Miss Effie Anderson, oh, was she a beautiful woman. And she was married, as far as I remember, his name was Dudley McLaughlin from East End. And nobody
ever touched him.
I'm sure you might have had a taste of it, Steve.
Remember now, Miss Effie, Miss Essay, I know who she is now. Yes. She was Mr. Dudley's wife. Dudley was a policeman.
Hello?
I say Mr. Dudley was also a policeman.
Yes, Miss Essay, and you know, I think it was his brother who married Mr. McLaughlin and had the gas station down by the Dixon graveyard. I'm not positive. Yes. He's a brother or a cousin.
So she was the niece of Miss Una.
I'm not positive about the niece, but many years ago I was told of the relationship, but that's a long time ago, Steve, so I really wouldn't like to say exactly. But she was related to her.
Yes.
So I just wanted you to get that straight. And thank you very much.
Thank you for that information. I will store that in my mind now. I know that now. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms. Georgette, for that. I think we have about 2 minutes before we go to the news. But Dr. MacPhail, in the legal profession, I think there is something called referred to as, when it comes to a person's right to defend themselves.
That's right.
Equality of arms.
That's right.
If you can have a QC, I should have the ability to match,
you know,
what you're bringing against me. How is it that we can't take that concept and transfer it into firearms?
But we,
arming people. Now, there are a lot of people who are opposed to that whole idea of people being armed, but you have to fight fire with fire.
Exactly. And, you know, people did have the right to defend themselves with their firearms and before. People had a legitimate right to have a firearms before. I remember when a shotgun license for the year was 5 shillings and a revolver license was 10 shillings. I used shotguns and when I was young, 14, 15 years old, with my grandparents and my uncles, my grandfather and my uncles, for hunting, because that is what we had it for. We hung hunting rabbits and hunting birds and hunting ducks. And we didn't have any incidents of violence with them in those days. And I don't understand why you said that. How can you ask a security guard to secure your valuables when the criminals have the firearms to attack him and he has nothing to defend himself? That is very asinine and it's very foolish indeed. And so we should set up a committee, a firearms board, to allow people who are qualified to have the firearms to defend themselves. The firearm board should perhaps have 3 people. There may be a policeman on it and 2 justices of the peace.
Mm-hmm. Folks, we're going to headline news. We're going to the news now at 8 o'clock. Please stay tuned for The Record. We'll be back immediately after the news. Good morning and welcome back to For the Record. In the studio with me this morning, Dr. Steve MacPhail. We're talking about crime. Dr. MacPhail, in his opening remarks this morning, expressed his concern about the recent robbery on Saturday night, and we've heard other callers express their views on it as well. We've been talking about the ability to, or the inability for some people to be armed to protect themselves. And then there are some questions that others have raised. For instance, what is the public's responsibility to help to deter crime? And when we talk about the public, we talk about, you know, those people who may see or know something. We always say, if you see something, say something. A lot will be seen as well. Others have questioned the Royal Cayman Islands Police Service, the use of body cams, as well as the use of other sophisticated equipment to detect or to help to deter crime. Some have asked why the police service, if there are any photos available, any camera shots of the suspects in the robbery, if they're available, why aren't they publicized? They may have their reasons for not publicizing them at this point in time, but do they want to wait until they reach a desperate situation and then put the photographs out there, which may be a little bit too late as well? So lots of questions in that regard, Dr.
Well, that's a foolish policy, not to publish the pictures of the suspects or the people you're looking for. You're looking for somebody who you suspect has committed an offense in your community. You have to put a picture out so people can help you. If people don't know who you're looking for, who they're looking for, how can they help you, really? And because it might be your neighbor. And if you saw the picture, then you know we can say, oh, it was my neighbor or the person I saw down the street a couple of days ago. You know, it's a very dumb policy. If I may say so, it doesn't make any sense whatsoever. It's bad policing. And a caller off the air reminded me of the fact that when the CMA, I think it is,
the Cayman Islands Monetary Authority
is moving money from one place to the other. They have security. They have armed security. I understand that they have policemen. Quite a show of force with machine guns, yeah. With machine guns to protect themselves. Not only do they have body armor, but they have machine guns to protect themselves. So I don't understand why these security guards, I'm not saying every security guard should have a firearm. I'm not indicating that at all. Mm-hmm. What I'm saying that security guard, especially when they're moving money and our precious commodities like gold and jewelry and stuff, they ought to be armed to protect themselves because you cannot. How can really protect himself with just a bullet vest? Like the caller said, to protect it from getting shot in the heart, they can also shoot him in the arm and shoot him in the head and shoot him in the legs. And so it seems to me that the security guard ought to be trained properly to have the firearms to protect themselves, especially when they're moving funds. And if that is not so, then they ought to put a policeman along with them. When they're moving funds, they can pay the policeman to do that, or they can pay the police department to do that when they're moving funds. If it comes down to push to shove that they do not want to give a police security guard arms at all because they're scared that they might commit an offense with the weapons, that they should have a policeman with them when they're moving up. And I don't understand. You know that money is being moved every night or every week or every month or twice a month or whatever. Why is it that you don't have the police presence in those areas when that is happening? I don't understand that. But that also goes to say, why is it that there's no policeman walking in my neighborhood who knows me, who knows my neighbors and everything? Why there's no policeman on the beat?
Mm-hmm. Two callers. Let's go to the phone lines. First caller, good morning. Welcome to For the Record.
Yeah, good morning, O.C. How are you?
Morning, I'm fine, thanks.
And yeah, you had a good ride, eh?
Yes, yes, good ride yesterday.
I didn't expect to stay this morning after that, but I don't know. That means that you're good and fit. Good to
well,
know.
100 miles is standard for me on a weekend.
Yeah, that's okay. Good to hear you. Mr. Matthews, good morning, sir.
Good morning.
Gentlemen, I've beaten the same horse again. I continue to say, why doesn't the Cayman Islands government put out the photos on TV of the person that is a suspect? I remember quite clearly, I called in a few, like a year and a half ago, about the same incident. And we had Mr. Ben Mead call back on the radio to correct me and said that it is, that, that is, they cannot put the picture of the person on the TV because it is not prohibited. And I remember one time I was in New York and they had a robbery at a gas station. And I was sitting in a restaurant, and within 10 minutes, that robber was in that restaurant, and his picture was on the TV, and the lady that was behind the counter recognized it right away and quietly went to the back and called the police, and they caught this gentleman. I don't know what's wrong with the Cayman Islands, because the security guards is a joke. Go to Honduras. I can just talk about Honduras. They got gun, they got mace, they got handcuff, they got machete, they got rifle. Their security guard, either security guard that somebody, a criminal coming to them, they gonna run for their life. They have to run. They don't have no protection.
But caller, my understanding of Honduras, I've never been there, but it sounds as if every Tom, Dick, and Harry is allowed to carry a gun there as well.
Yes, yeah. And mm-hmm. it's also a mother capital, a mother country in Latin America too.
Tegucigalpa is one of the capital of the world.
If you're going to the banks, you're well protected because you don't have to worry. They protect you. But Cayman don't have no security guard. This is a joke. These security guards are in danger, gentlemen, because they have no protection. So thank you very much, but I wish that they could have a law that they could put the suspects on the TV. I don't know what was the reason why they're protecting them, just like what you said just now, Mr. Markfield. It could be your neighbor. We don't know. Thank you very much.
Thank you, caller. Let's go to the next caller. Good morning. Welcome to For the Record.
Good morning.
Morning, sir.
Mr. Markfield.
Good morning.
I agree with you 100% what you were saying about, you know, that it should be armed guns and things. But I often wonder, shouldn't these cash registers and bags and stuff like that all have alarm system? Like, when they're packing the money and they're leaving and all that, that should be available, that they can set off an alarm automatically, you know, once it happens, that they can trace it then. You know, just like have a black box that you trace these black boxes
Yes.
Why can't they get to that system?
I don't know if it's probably they haven't. Technology hasn't caught up with them, or they haven't catch up with technology, or they just don't want to spend that kind of money.
Well, someone remarked yesterday that the merchants usually have their funds insured. They're insured one way or the other. Either the security company or the merchants, whatever is being transported is insured. So they're assured of getting a replacement from the insurance companies at the end of the day. Say, so it seems as if there's less incentive for them to have the protection out there. So the poor security guards are the ones whose lives and safety are put at risk as a result of the perceived attitude that the other companies are taking. We're insured, so yes, we don't have to worry about anything.
And at risk for $6 to $8 an hour.
Yes, yes. Caller, I want to thank you. I think we have one more caller. Three calls. Caller, good morning. Welcome to For the Record.
And good morning, OC, and good morning, Dr. Steve.
Good morning.
This is Kenneth Bryan.
Good morning.
I'm just listening to your conversation, and Dr. Steve has made some valid points. Maybe this is a good opportunity for the Royal Cayman Police Service to now start making some money in respect to armed services. You know, they can help with their own budget by offering an armed service with all of these
Very difficult caller to do that. Sorry to interrupt you, but government's position is, in terms of not competing against the private sector in these matters. So if government doesn't want to compete, then they must give the private sector the ability to allow them the ability to do their job, which means offering the ability for some of their employees to be armed.
Well, OC, I agree with you. This is not a competition suggestion that I'm saying. They will still have their guards carrying the money around, but what you would have in is an escort service with an armed officer. So you still have your security guards who's doing the transfer and the paperwork and all that.
Okay.
But the police would just offer a service at a cost just to drive around with you in your different points. And I'm quite sure they'll have officers who are trained in armed services, because the fear that I would have is now having persons in the private sector having arms. I think a lot of people wouldn't be comfortable with that outside of the Royal Cayman Police Service. And based on the UK model of policing, only the police themselves should have arms. So I'm thinking that there's an opportunity there for government to recoup some fees. And I think the private sector would be happy to accept that and pay for that cost because of the fair level that is there. Just a thought, but the conversation is good, and thank you for allowing me to give
it. Thank you very much, caller. We have going to the phone line in a second, but I want to also read some of the things that persons have sent in as well. Poor education equals poverty. Poverty equals crime. So, therefore, poor education also equals crime. Said, if we don't fix education, crime will continue to get worse. Caller, good morning. Welcome to For the Record.
Yes, good morning. I just want to follow up on one a caller just called a while ago about reference to Honduras.
Yes.
I've been to Honduras I think two or three times, and I happened to at one time go in a bank, and yes, there are security guards there with, I guess, M16 guns. When I think they're huge, long guns, and I thought that was very uncomfortable. I would not like to see Cayman get to that position where they have to have guns, with security guards with guns in a bank. There is a need for, I realize the person that not against guns. I was not for it. I remember when Cayman didn't have any security guards at all. I love that feeling. But things have changed. So I think I want to go with Dr. McPhee when he was saying about, or maybe you, I don't know who it was, if people are going to be transferring money, then they need to have some sort of higher security system that they have right now, because that is not working. And you cannot have someone who is someone who's securing funds that don't have any guns while you have people who want to take it coming to them with guns.
Mm-hmm.
That the playing field is not level, so something needs to be done. I like the idea of what you mentioned about the currency board, when they have their police officers guarding the funds when they're transferring. This is something that could be implemented around to these business places who have transferred these large sums of money. So that's all I have to say. I really would like to see come to Honduras, where you're cramped up in the bank, and there's this guard. It's not a good feeling.
Yeah, you almost feel like you're living in a police state then, yes.
Exactly. Okay, that's all I have to say. Thank you.
Thank you very much, caller. We have a few callers on hold. We're going to ask them to hang tight there. We're going to take a commercial break. When we return, For the Record, we'll be taking your call immediately. So please stay tuned.
What is on your mind when it comes to the government, independence, and the opposition? Issues that matter to you. 1-800-534-8255. Waiting to hear from you. For the Record, with your host, Orit Connor.
Good morning and welcome back to For the Record. We're in the studio here, and I have with me Dr. Steve McPhee. We're discussing crime in the Cayman Islands. Specifically, we're discussing the recent robbery at the Foster's Food Fair location and airport Road in Georgetown. And we don't want to say too much. We don't know too much about it, but at the same time, we want to talk about this particular incident. There was a previous incident a few weeks ago on Eastern Avenue as well, an attempt. We would have thought that that incident would have sent some warning signals out there to security companies, to merchants and everyone, to review the procedures that they have in place and to see how they could be tightened up. If they did that, obviously, it didn't work in this instance as well. As promised, we were going straight to the phone lines. Caller, good morning. Welcome to For the Record.
Yeah, how are you guys doing this morning?
Fine. How are you?
Good morning.
Not too bad. Sad to hear what took place, but I really get concerned when I hear you're going to put, or anyone suggesting to put firearms in a lowly paid person's hand. I think they need to address the salary of those individuals that are doing that security work, because one of the main deterrents for security guards going corrupt is their salary. And if you're going to put firearms in the mix and giving them between $5 to $7 an hour, there's something wrong with that.
Because
the world is out there, and you can go and compare and see what armed security guards get in other parts of the world, and there's a reason why they get paid good salaries, because they're expected to protect, even to the point of laying down their life. And I don't want to see a poorly paid person with a firearm. I have my reasons for that. No, I just don't want to see that being a norm in Cayman. You want the best of the best. I mean, that's the story we get when it comes to hiring anybody in Cayman, the best of the best. And paying them $5 to $7 an hour and expect them to guard money, guard your life, guard your property, that opens the door for all kind of crap.
Excellent point, caller. Excellent.
I'll leave you there with that. I'm long with
Thank you very much. Excellent point, Doc. Before we go to the next call, Dr. Steve, you
want
to...
Excellent point with that, but I just want to ask you, caller, then, if you pay them $10 and $15 an hour, and you, but you don't give them any security, how are they going to guard the money that they move from time from place? But it's not the issue. Really, is not the it's not the amount of money that they're getting. The amount of money they're getting is detriment to the risk of their lives. I would say, but that does not deter the robber who wants to take the money that they're carrying.
Okay, I just want to also read. Excerpt from an article in the Jamaica Gleaner, today's Jamaica Gleaner, and the International Monetary Fund, the IMS, their country representative for Jamaica, says that crime continues to be a major impediment to Jamaica's economic stability. We here in the Cayman Islands have to be extremely, extremely careful that we do not find ourselves in that situation. And how do we at least try to ensure that we don't find ourselves in that situation? To nip it in the bud now. And those career criminals who are out there, take them and lock them down. Just bear in mind that not everyone can be rehabilitated. There are some who need to be removed from society and put separately because they threaten society's survival. Let's go to the phone lines. Caller, good morning. Welcome to For the Record. Good morning, caller. Welcome to For the Record.
Yeah, good morning. How are you today?
Fine. How are you?
Good morning.
I'm good. I was listening earlier talk where someone was talking about, you know, the lack of education is one of the things you don't have, get more people employed and stuff like that. But
no, what the person said was, and I'll read it to you again, poor education equals poverty. Mm-hmm. Poverty equals crime. So poor education equals crime. And if we don't fix the education, crime will continue to get worse.
And I agree with
That's what they said.
Yeah, well, I agree with that. But the thing is that the thing that I wanted to say was this. The other night, I think Saturday night, I listened to Don Seymour gave a really good speech up at the BBM opening there. And he was talking about how he grew up, and it's more in life. Opportunity is more important sometimes than education. If you think about the number of us that went to sea, worked on ships, started off as a messman, come back as second engineer, chief mates, all kinds of, you know, people that really were dedicated and wanted to get ahead. And yet, they didn't have any school learning, per se. They had opportunity. That's the problem in Cayman now. These people that come here with open up businesses and stuff like that tell us, well, we need to get a degree in this, get a degree in that. But I don't care. You could have a double master's in something. But if you have no experience in what you're doing, you can't handle a job. We have to start giving people opportunity that they can get the education, the basics of what they need to do, along with the degrees that they get from school. Because you see, you get people come to school now with degrees and stuff like that, and then you go to some of these places, the employment, and they ask, they want to get a job, and they say, well, you don't have no experience. How do you get experience unless you give me opportunity? Mm-hmm. You know, these are the things that really confound me sometimes when I listen to these things. Because Don Seymour did, and I said that had he not had people, and he named people who had assisted him, gave him the opportunity, he would never have been where he is today. You see what I'm saying?
Yep.
These are the things we have to take a good look at and not listen to what people want to tell us because it's convenient for them to say. But we have to give people, especially young people. Mm-hmm.
Thank you very much, caller, for that. Next caller, any more calls?
Good morning, Mr. V.
Morning, sir. How are you?
Good morning, Dr. Mayfield. It's Paul Hurlston.
Good morning, Captain Hurlston.
Yeah, about this situation, I think I have a little experience with security guard. I was 7 years at CUC.
CUC, yes.
And I suggested many times about transfer. That was one of my jobs to go with the cashier to transfer. But it's a simple solution to this thing, but people will not listen. Mm-hmm. You do not deliver money at the same time every day. And not at the same person, do not do it.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
It's simple to think because people, they don't know when you come in, how can they wait for you? You do it sometime in the morning, sometime at midday, sometime in the evening time. You keep reversing it and have different people do it.
Right, you remain unpredictable.
That's right. You have to be able to think like those people to catch them.
Yes.
So many ideas I have, I could tell people because I've been through it. That's like when I was on the ship, stowaways. By law, you're supposed to post sailing time on before 24 hours before you sail. I warned my crew I would put the right time but the wrong day. If I was sailing Friday, I would put it for Saturday, but the right same time because the stowaway not coming aboard at 24 hours before you sail. So there's this simple little solution that could be solved, but nobody will listen to me because I'm local.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Thank you for hearing, for allowing me to George it with zero on my mouth.
Thank you very much. Captain Paul. One listener says most security guards are all trained in firearms, or trained in firearms, as some of them are armed forces or ex-service
ex-army
persons.
Ex-army and ex-policemen.
And we do need laws to allow them to carry. Because the law prohibits them from carrying guns now. And they also say that the Royal Cayman Islands Police Service does a good job, but they can't be everywhere. They also say, don't tell me that with all the persons at Foster's, no one saw anything. No one saw anything as well. Two callers. Let's go to the phone lines. Caller, good morning. Welcome to For the Record.
Morning again, gentlemen.
Morning again, sir.
Good morning. This
is Danny Warren Jr. here.
Okay.
I don't agree with the notion that police officers should be doing it. The reason for that is that police officers provide general security and not specific security. That's the point of a security officer. Secondly, there's no difference between having a well-trained police officer and a well-trained security officer. Security police officers are not indispensable as individuals. Anybody can be trained properly to do something. On the point about pay, if you want to raise someone's pay for that, that's fine. We need to do what we need to do. But if we're going to be arguing that police officers should be doing it, I assure you those police officers who are armed are not making an extremely high salary. So you might want to look at their pay as well.
Okay.
But suffice it to say this, right? Even if you were to look at it from the perspective of we have insurance, so why do you need a firearm? You just get reimbursed. Well, we're looking at the life of the individual. They're being shot. It's only a matter of time before one of them will actually die. And the question is...
Well, we had that happen. As a matter of fact, it was around about this time of the year in Easter that Mr. Miles was shot.
That's right.
When depositing, yes.
Right. And so the point that here is we're talking about protection of life. Not this isn't just about money, but the individual's life. On a legal point, the comment was just made that they're not allowed to carry firearms. That's not my understanding of the law. My understanding is that I can't remember the I think it's the security law that allows the deputy governor to prescribe a list of devices from which the commissioner of police could license a security officer to carry. And it's just a matter of that policy being made. It's not that the law doesn't allow it to occur.
But you wouldn't want to put a taser up against a real firearm.
Yes.
I'm saying never take a knife to a gunfight.
Caller, it's my opinion, my personal opinion, I do not believe that one man should have the discretion to grant a license for a firearm or not to grant a license for firearms. I don't think that should be in the sole discretion of one person alone in this country. I would rather see a firearm licensing board where you have three people to look at the applications and license the firearms or not license them. And the police could be involved. It could be one police person from the police department because they do have an interest, and it should be two justices of the peace and from the community.
Caller, I want to thank you. We have to go to a commercial break now. When we return, the conversation will continue with Dr. Steve MacPhail and the callers that we have on hold as well. Please stay tuned for the record. We'll be back shortly. Good morning. Welcome back to For the Record. One caller on hold. Straight to the phone lines. Caller, good morning. Welcome to For the Record.
Good morning, Mr. O'Connor.
Morning, sir.
And good morning to Dr. Steve.
Good morning. Good morning, sir.
I heard your conversation earlier based on the education system. Matter of fact, where the vocational training is concerned. I did make a suggestion some time back that there are certain of our elected officials who do not wish to see money spent and big buildings. But for us to get a vocational training, our vocational school go on, we have to have an establishment put towards for the community, for those who are not in school and will be willing to get a trade somewhere down the line.
When you say an establishment, do you mean to have a physical structure or to have a system in place?
Well, a physical structure would be good, based on mechanical cabinet making, stuff like that.
Okay,
I know that it works elsewhere, but when we really have politicians are people who are elected to run the country that against these kind of things. then we are basically holding down our youth. It doesn't, if we're going to spend, if we want to see progress in this country, to where the youths are concerned, as you said, if you have them idling on the street, have nothing to do, then they're going to go out, they're going to do things that is not suitable to where the law is concerned. We have to get the training in place for them. We have the SciFec program that's going on. I think the SciFec is a start, but I think we can go further. A school has to put in place. I'd rather it by between the government and the private sector or otherwise. But without a training school on this island, our youth will leave behind. We have the education system is not as bad as a lot of people is talking. And we cannot blame, and every day we get up and say that the education system is poor. We have good education system on Ireland. Yes, it needs improvement, but we need to put the vocational training school in place where our youths and those who left school and don't have a diploma or whatever it is to go forward can take that initiative.
Okay. Thank you very much, caller, okay. for that point. Now, Dr. Steve, we don't know a lot about what took place on Saturday night. We don't know whether or not the robbery took place between the pickup point and the vehicle, or at the vehicle, or where. We don't have a lot of information at this point in time. Royal Cayman Islands Police Service have not put out a whole lot of information, and not that we want a whole lot of information from the police. What we do want, though, is if the police has information that they have information that they need, then reach out to the public. I know they've put out something, say, you know, anyone who witnessed or anyone who knows anything about it to come forward. But at the same time, if you need to identify someone, we talked about photographs earlier, if they're available, you know, put them out there. If it's we don't know if it's an inside job, if it's, you know, something that was done
exactly
on the inside. Maybe the companies did have a policy where they didn't have a regular scheduled pickup time, but staggered those pickup time. We don't know whether or not the robbers may have followed the vehicle and took advantage, you know, of that situation as well. There are so many unknowns in relation to this particular robbery. We hear some people have suggested that in financial institutions like banks, they have decoy bags with money that emit some sort of ink or dye or something like that. They may have decoy bags. They may have bags with trackers in them that you can electronically track the movement.
Yes.
Of the parcels and stuff like that. We don't know, you know, what the police or the security firms have at their disposal.
That's right. And, you know, I was just speaking to you off the air, telling you of my experience in Canada.
Mm-hmm.
And my ex-father-in-law was a Royal Bank manager in Canada. And I would go down to the Royal Bank a lot. In fact, I worked at the Royal Bank in the Genie Center, in the computer center, from 11 o'clock at night to 7 o'clock in the morning. And they had security in the bank, but I didn't know who the security was until I got to work there.
Mm-hmm.
Because the security guard was just like everybody else, dressed in his suit and moving in the bank, sometimes behind the counter, sometimes not behind the counter, and he had his service revolver under his jacket, and you never knew. You thought that he was a nice businessman, a nice supervisor or something in the bank, but they were the security guards in the bank.
Mm-hmm. Now what about, we talked about police officers earlier, and some persons have expressed their skepticism about arming persons who are paid $5 an hour. We see in some jurisdictions where police officers who are off duty are allowed to work for private companies.
That's right.
They serve as security guards at nightclubs and other venues. What about the ability of police officers having a second job, what they call moonlighting, and being able to work for these companies? That would remove the argument in terms of licensing, firearms licensing. It would probably, it would also help to enhance the financial situation, financial position of police officers, who many people believe are underpaid for the job that they do here.
Of course,
when you compare Cayman to other jurisdictions, they may be considered to be well paid, but when you consider the cost of living in the Cayman Islands, some people may say it's not. But what about the ability to police officers to do that? And then there would be a stronger argument for arming them.
Well, Orrit, that's the reason why when you call me, I come to your show. Because you have the ability, you're a thinker. Mm-hmm. And you think far ahead. And you will take a question or a problem and you will analyze it to the end.
Thank you.
And that is an excellent idea. And I do not understand why the policeman cannot be allowed, like as they say, to moonlight, to have a second job. Especially when it's in the same field.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not in favor of the policeman going driving a taxi, for instance,
mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
unless he's doing some surveillance job,
right,
undercover and doing some surveillance job. But there's no reason why a policeman can't act as a security in a bank or in a nightclub or things like that and get paid. And that like you say, that would solve a lot of the nightclub problems, and it would solve a lot of the robbery problems, and it would give more security and more security to us in our community. That's an excellent idea, and I think that the commissioner of police or the deputy commissioner of police is listening, or the people who are in charge of them listening, mm-hmm, today, mm-hmm. They should take that idea and run with it.
Yeah, and also canvass the police officers to see how they feel as well. Folks, I want to remind you that you're listening to For the Record. I'm your host, Dorrit Connor. My guest in the studio with me this morning, Dr. Steve Macfield. We have one caller. We're going to headline news. When we return, we will take that caller. So, caller, please hang in there. You will be the first online when we return. Good morning. Welcome back to For the Record. We're going straight to the phone lines. Caller, good morning. Welcome to For the Record. Thanks for being so patient.
Hey, OC, I'm going to give you one reason why they should not have a second job. And the reason is that if you have a person who's armed, they need to be well rested. Working two jobs is going to create too much fatigue for them.
Well, it depends. I would agree that the potential is there, but it depends on how that person's schedule is. I think some officers, it's like 4 days on and then a certain amount of days off as well. So that is something that can be worked through. And you have how many persons are actual officers, uniform officers, are in the police service? I don't know, maybe 200 and odd, 300 and odd. So you have a wide range to choose from, caller.
If a person has days off, the 4 days off, that's a legitimate point. A person perhaps could work a couple of those. But the number of officers who are actually trained in firearms is all of the officers.
Mm-hmm. Train all of them. They all should be.
Okay. But for the purposes of security, what you're saying then is that the schedules for those officers would have to line up with when security companies need those people. And that's another logistical challenge.
That's easy to do. This is a small place that everybody know each other. It's easy to call her to work out the logistics of that. That's not a science. That's ordinary employment planning.
Mm-hmm.
With
taking into consideration what Captain Hollerson said about the
the schedule and how it has to be flexible.
Yeah. Well, what about retired police officers as well?
That's fine.
Mm-hmm.
That's fine. But the point I'm trying to make is that people who are out using firearms, one of the number one things about using a firearm is safety. And what you need is a clear thinking person.
Mm-hmm.
And a person who's tired is more prone to make mistakes. I would rather we train people who that's what they do. They get their rest, they do their job. I would prefer that than overworking police officers.
Okay, caller, thank you very much. Your point is well taken, but I believe that is something that could be easily be worked around as well. One more caller. Caller, good morning. Welcome to For the Record.
We'll see.
Morning.
How are you?
Fine, and yourself?
Oh, not bad. Could be a lot better, but, you know, when considering where I'm at, you know, I shouldn't really complain, but I have to complain this morning. Good morning to Mr. Macfield, too. Maybe my question,
I'll put
it to Mr. Macfield, and maybe he can answer the question. And then I'll hang up and listen to your answer.
Sure.
Mr. Macfield, also you can jump into if you like. Why is it so difficult for a Caymanian to get a job in this country? I mean, I drive around every day pretty much looking work, and all I can see is, don't get me wrong, I don't have nothing against foreigners coming to this country to work. But you know what they always say, charity starts at home, right? And I'll add another little bit to it. You know, I was trying to get on to one of the talk shows last Friday because one of the members was on there, and they were telling us all about, you know, their achievements for the year. Well, you know what? We got three radio stations that I listen to frequently. Cayman Radio Talk Today?
Mm-hmm.
And yours is For the Record. Yours, Rooster. Hello? Still
yes,
there?
Yes, we're listening. We just blocked out the competition's name, that's all. Okay. Sorry, we didn't
Thank
do
you.
That.
Rooster, and you had Austin, the three radio stations, and none of the politicians choose to come on to the radios and let the people of this country know it. What they've been doing. I mean, I had to practically wait 4 years for the government to come and tell us what they have done for the last 4 years. You know, I would like to be briefed when things are done, even if it's not till a month afterwards or 2 months or 3 months, not 4 years, because my assumption now, I am assuming that if you can't come and tell us something that you have done, well, you know, as far as I'm concerned, you have done nothing.
But caller, do you think it is also this responsibility of the citizen to try to be as aware as possible, listen to the news? We encourage our listeners on here to follow the proceedings of the Legislative Assembly live, those who can follow it, and those who can't, then you get a rebroadcast of it in the evenings, you know, as well. Yes, some people are busy at work, so they don't have the time to dedicate to it, but don't you think it's a shared responsibility? I understand what you're saying about your politicians and your elected representatives, and I see with you on that.
I totally agree with you, OC. I mean, you know, there's all different types of people. People spend their time going about picking up news and listening to news. They have nothing else to do. But I spend all of my time trying to find a job in this country.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't have the time to listen to what the government is saying, you know, because, I mean, I'm always on the road. But I would just like Mr. Macfield to answer that question. Why is it so difficult for us in this country as Caymanians to get a job? It is not right, and something needs to be changed.
Don't hang up yet, caller. One more question for you before you go. This new builder's bill that has just been enacted, do you have any confidence that that bill, when enacted, will help your situation in terms as a Caymanian in terms of finding a job? Because my understanding is that those persons who go out there and freelance now are allowed to freelance because me as a prospective employer won't be able to just simply go out there and hire anyone, but it has to be someone who is licensed, properly licensed, and everything else. Do you feel that the builder's bill will help you in any way?
It will, in a way, because it's funny you mentioned that, because I was just talking about that this morning to a mate of mine, right?
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, we were going back years ago when this problem always, when this problem started. It started with the architects, right? They first was happy doing their drawings. And then they started getting involved in construction. They started telling customers, well, you know, we can manage this, we can do it, and all of this kind of, and then from then, one architect started it, I'm not going to call the name, and then from then, it took off, right? And there was no control. Nobody could tell the architects or the QSs, mainly the architects, that, you know, they have to have a separate license if they want to run a business separate outside of their architect business. Nobody said anything to them. So they see another way they could have money coming in, and they went for it. So, yes, I agree. I think that the builder's law, that's going to make a lot of difference. But, you know, another problem, again, we have in this country, OC, is enforcement. Mm-hmm. You know, we have laws on the books for God knows how long. People even forget about them, not until something comes up that they say, well, oh, yeah, but, oh, God, that's 20 years ago. I forgot about it. And there's no enforcement whatsoever. People are not reminded of these laws that are in place. You forget about such a laws. And this also needs to be changed. I mean, if there's laws in place, they need to be enforced. I mean, I could go on and on forever and tell you some of my issues I have. But, you know, there's people that have 10 times worse than I do, so I'm not going to go there. So I just like Mr. Maxfield, maybe if he could touch on that, you know, subject of, you know, why the people in this country cannot get work.
Okay.
All right. Thank you very much, gentlemen.
Thank you very much, caller. Dr. Maxfield, bear that in mind. We're gonna grab one more caller before we go to the commercial break and then give you an opportunity to respond to all of them.
And he must have been reading my mind because I wanted to do some closing. Uh-huh. And that's included.
Okay,
in my closing remarks.
Excellent, excellent. Caller, good morning. Welcome to For the Record. You want to turn your radio off, please. 1-800-534-8255. That's a number you can call us on here on For the Record. That's a toll-free number. 949-8037 and 949-6990 as well. Caller, good morning. Welcome to For the Record.
Morning. How are you doing? Fine.
How are you?
I'm morning. Is Dr. Steve Maxfield.
Good morning, sir.
Yeah, I call in. I don't usually call too often. You know?
I know, but when I see you, we talk.
yes. But, you know, I don't know. The Cayman Islands is one unique place. And the problem I had is that when I came here, nobody wanted to come here. And all of a sudden, now, everybody seems to want to own it.
Mm-hmm.
On the Cayman Islands. You see, but I'm not really worried about myself now because I've lived a full life here. I actually grew up here.
Mm-hmm.
I came here when I was 18 years old. And the Cayman Islands has not gone the way I thought. It should have gone. Right now, I'm going to give you this. Now, we got some arrogant police officers here in Jamaica. I guess you don't even know, but I was arrested the other day.
No, not aware.
Can you imagine me arrested in the Cayman Islands? Huh? For a smaller infringement, stupidity, because these guys here are bringing the Jamaican police in here in the Cayman Islands, and it cannot work. Jamaica's a crazy place, Ossie. We don't. I have an example now. I'm not calling anybody's name, but this guy told me that a police officer followed a young Caymanian girl in his complex, and because she opened her mouth, she was hustled to the ground, handcuffed and put in the police car. Now, you know something. Something is radically wrong around here, man. I know the Caymans went joining the police force. The reason, I do not know. They're leaving. They're going to the customs, so every and anybody can join the police force. It seems like to me. You come here a construction worker this week, next week, you're in the police force.
Mm-hmm.
I don't understand. I had to train for 6 long months away from my mother before I could come here. So I don't really understand what's going on. Another thing now, I think the Cayman Islands were lost over 40 years ago. I'm going to give an example.
I was here. I was married to Caymanian. I had two children born in the Cayman Islands, and could not get a work permit. I was offered a work permit to Mark Albine back then and could not get the permit. Mm-hmm. I got the first, I think she's one of the first local qualified Caymanian lawyers, Mrs. Webb, to write a letter, and that not even that worked. So I never got the job. Mm-hmm. Chefs come here and got two permits before a friend of mine, I'm not going to call his name, a friend of mine and I got a permit. He got two permits. He didn't like where he was working. He shifted from there and he went and got another permit. So over there, people talking about Cayman has been lost 40 years ago because I got fired from the Holiday Inn for fighting for Caymanians. They give me a little supervisor job to shut my mouth, but I can't keep my mouth. I got to die. I cannot keep my mouth shut. And I'm not going to keep my mouth shut when I see something is going wrong, you see. They gave me a little supervisor job, and I told them, anytime they want somebody from the front desk or whatever, they're bringing in somebody, bringing this. I said, why don't you all train the Cayman people and have a progressive system? Oh, but imagine wrote me a nice letter. Nice letter. He gave me a check, though, you know, he gave me a little check.
Caller, we're going to ask you to leave us there. We have to go to a commercial break now. But again, want to thank you very much for your contribution. Folks, please stay tuned for The Record. We'll be back shortly.
Information that matter for The Record with Orrit Connor continues right now on Radio Cayman.
Good morning and welcome back to For the Record, where I am happy to have in the studio with me again this morning, Dr. Steve MacPhail. I just want to say, preface what I'm going to say by saying that I'm really not here to defend the government or to defend any politician for that matter, but I'm here also to ensure that there is clarity and that there's balance in the discussion. And one caller, when referring to the fact that our politicians don't tell them, you know, what's going on, I have to say that, and I can speak solely for this show, For the Record, that we provided a format, a platform for the government on Mondays, the independent members on Wednesdays, and the official opposition on Fridays. And they all got opportunities to tell us what was going on in the Legislative Assembly, government to tell us what was going on, and they were represented. Government was the ministries, the respective ministries were represented on here. So that format was certainly in place on For the Record, and the caller did admit that he listens to three talk shows, including For the Record. So platform has always been out there, and all three entities that I mentioned earlier have taken advantage of that. Of course, it's paying time now, so they have to pay to play now, you know, on For the Record. Dr. MacPhail, I think we have about 10 minutes left. Ms. Susan, no calls, so we'll give Dr. MacPhail an opportunity to respond to all of the calls that we had in and may have had questions.
Well, I would like to respond to the call with the closing argument. I think that would give me time to do that.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Because I think one of the callers that called, he must have been reading my mind, because after this incident last night, Sergeant, and I decided to write a closing remark for today. I wasn't going to do it today. I was going to do it on Friday. But I wanted to read it. It says, employment and crime. The most destructive couple of evils plunging our country into unfathomable chaos are unemployment and crime. We are, it seems, forever bogged down in useless and unproductive theoretical debate about the causes, consequences, and solutions to unemployment. We engage numerous high-powered experts to tell us how to solve these islands' dilemma. yet unemployment continues to be one of the most critical socioeconomic menaces facing us. Some of the most glaring causes of our lack of employment are exposed for all of us to see. They are, one, an indentured slave minimum wage, a flawed immigration system that allows in cheap labor, an administrative money appetite that depends on work permit fees to feed its hunger, and a foolish deliberate policy not to train Caymanians for every aspects of the services of which we brag are the pillars of our economic stability. GOCS, good old Cayman common sense, that costs us nothing, tells us that good schools, relevant education, and training are the pillars to uphold preparation for participation and entitlement. Unemployment is the birth mother of crime and harm to our democracy. One wonders how long are we going to deny, hide behind statistics, and make excuses for empirical evidence that tells us that our heads are buried in the hindsight of the Constitution provisions that states that the policy and security, policing and security is not our business. Crime and security are our business. They have a debilitating negative effect on our GDP. Crime destroys our well-being, peace and tranquility that are supposed to be guarded and protected by the government. Crime creates fear in the home and panic in the community. Crime permits a crippling effect on the country. Crime will eventually lead to transitional and political instability. Using long prison sentences, a proliferation of policemen and prison guards have evidentially proven to be no deterrent to this crime wave. What we ought to be doing are some of the following: securing our borders tight as a cork in a bottle, create full employment by programs to prepare our people to work in the industries in our country, create after-school programs, tutoring centers, part-time work, and a national work program to keep our youth occupied and engaged and away from negative influences, counseling and job pursuit guidance, open up closed super expensive school premises for community discussion and interaction. To continue to ignore the reality of our realities of this destructible couple, employment and crime, is to remain mentally dead and intellectually deceived. It will be only a matter of a narrow time when we will experience our democracy slipping and sliding beyond our control, and the pathetic reactive cry will always be, well, if I had known, and if I had to do it all over again. Unfortunately, for some of our procrastinators, leaders, yesterday came before today. I had also been eminently stated that procrastinators may also be a form of psychological disorder. One wonders then, how do we look forward with anticipation to successfully combating and prevailing over these two evils that are rapidly destroying what we have inherited? A country peaceful and tranquil, built on grit, guts, and GOCS, good old Cayman common sense. Perhaps we will have to wait, barricaded in our homes, awaiting for the elected ones who care. Maybe they will guide us to a safe and secure community by the North Star. Nothing that has been stated mean anything to mediocre leaders. Howard Zinn has stated that imprisonment is a way of pretending to solve the problems of crime. It does nothing for the victim of crime, but perpetuates the idea of retribution. Thus maintaining the endless cycle of violence in all culture. It is a cruel and useless substitute for the elimination of those conditions, poverty, unemployment, homelessness, desperation, racism, greed, which are at the root of most punished crime. The crime of the rich and the powerful go unpunished and unexplained. So I ask this very vexing question. If violence and unemployment are to be the laws of the land, why are they putting up these large billboards, posters, to entice us to vote for a seat in a legislative assembly? After all, it is the Constitution from which peace, order, and good government is derived, not gun violence and hunger in the streets.
Okay, Dr. McPhail, thank you very much for that contribution to For the Record this morning as well. I'm going to go back to Friday's discussion, and I just, one of our listeners sent us some information. We're talking about Ms. Genevieve Smith Henning, and said that someone spoke to Ms. Jen, and it seems that she signed that petition for women's right to vote when she was in her 20s then. She was in her 20s at that time. They also says that she was raised by her dad's aunt, Nesta, who they believe also signed with the West Bay group that signed the petition. They went on to say, that Mr. Murphy, as they knew him, was related to Mr. Lee Smith, who is the father of Gwendolyn, Celine, Bruce Smith, and others. And then they make the comment that West Bay makes for a great study of how the families were connected. One that I didn't know about, and I would not have known about it because of my age, but Miss Iva Panton, who was the librarian, and she was married to Mr. Stanley.
That's right.
Mrs. Stanley Panton. She was from West Bay.
She was from West Bay also, yeah. Yes. And she was married to Mr. Stanley. Mr. Stanley, remember, was the lay minister. And I think he lived in Jamaica for a long time. And also, Mr. Stanley was the public recorder. Did you know that?
Yes.
He was the public recorder. He recorded birth, deaths, marriages, and also the land registry.
And he was served in Jamaica as a preacher. And then it seemed as if ill health then forced him to return to the Cayman Islands, because she was a part-time librarian at first, and then took over as a full-time librarian. I believe Miss Marcia may have been the librarian before that, and then when she transferred over to government, then Miss Ida.
Yes, and before that was Miss Leela Ross MacTaggart Shire. Miss Leela MacTaggart Ross Shire. Who was a librarian?
I want to look back on the profile that was done on Miss Leela as well, and read that one of these days on here. Folks, first of all, Dr. Steve, I want to thank you again for being with me this morning. Look forward to having you again on Wednesday, and then we have the holidays after that for a few days. I want to also thank our audience, viewing and listening audience, for allowing Radio Cayman, and by extension For the Record, into your homes, into your vehicles as you traverse the busy roads of the Cayman Islands, including the new stretch of Linford Pearson Highway that is now open, and we ask you to be extremely careful on it. It is very easy to navigate, despite the fact that I know some drivers out there are just make things difficult for themselves. Some of them make them difficult for themselves by speeding. Others make it difficult by sometimes going a little bit too cautiously, you know, as well. But I want to thank you for listening to For the Record. I also want to remind you that we are our brothers and our sisters' keepers. There is always someone there who's less fortunate than we are, and I ask you to extend a helping hand to them. If you can't do that, then I suggest you donate to a worthy charity, because we always want to consider those who need, not necessarily those who want to say to you, have a great day. Continue to support your radio station, Radio Cayman, during Sterling Dwayne Ebanks at 12 noon for talk today. Have a wonderful, wonderful day. And as usual, we ask the good Lord to bless these three wonderful, beautiful Cayman Islands.